If I had been properly supported in 1919, I think we might have strangled Bolshevism in its cradle. But everybody turned up their hands and said, how shocking. But I am not anti-Russian. I am violently anti-communist.
If you go onto Google and you look up a map of the Russian Civil War, the first thing you'll notice is that the Reds were reduced to a small part of Russia. And you might wonder, how did this happen? Did it unfold in stages? Was it gradual? No, it happened pretty much all at once. Most of that territory was lost in one blow, with a thing called the Czechoslovak Revolt. It unfolded over maybe 2 months, 3 months. Really, when it comes right down to it, the Reds lost that vast territory in the moment when a piece of a cast iron stove was flung across a railway yard by a Hungarian prisoner of war. But we'll get to that. This post will tell the story of the Czechoslovak Revolt, the story of how the Eastern Front of the Russian Civil War blazed up in spring 1918. The major players were the Allied powers, the Right SRs, the officers and the Cossacks. So far, a familiar cast of characters for the counter-revolution, but the biggest part of the heavy lifting was done by an outfit called the Czechoslovak Corps, or also known as the Czechoslovak Legion, an improbable but enormously significant presence in Russia in 1918. This is Revolution Under Siege, a series of podcasts about the Russian Civil War. This podcast comes to you from the 1919 Review, a blog on history and culture. Look us up at 1919review.wordpress.com. There, among many other things, you can find the text version of this podcast with all the citations, the images, the latest updates, etc. Let's start with the Allies, in laying the groundwork for how the Czechoslovak Revolt happened. The first piece of context here is the implacable hatred with which the October Revolution was greeted by the wealthy and powerful in the Allied countries, that is, France, Britain, Japan, to a lesser extent the United States, Italy, etc. All over the world, there were many who sympathised with the revolution. From the industrial workers of the world in the United States, known as the Wobblies, to followers of the late James Connolly in Ireland, who went to his death a year before the Russian Revolution. But in politics and media, it was a different story. They reported that Lenin, quote, alias Zederblaum, was secretly Jewish, and that he and Trotsky were busy murdering one another in drunken brawls over gambling debts. The Red Guards, who were, quote, chiefly Latvians and Chinese, end quote, had spent the spring of 1918, supposedly, gunning down crowds of people in the cities. Now, it was chaotic enough in Russia at the time, and there were some very awful things happening. They didn't need to make up all this elaborate stuff, but they did. And their viewpoint was fundamentally distorted. They didn't have a grasp of what was going on in Russia. They saw the revolution, first of all, only through the prism of the war. With the Russians out of the war, they believed, the Germans would soon be in Paris, and the Turks would soon be on the borders of India. The Russian revolutionaries were assumed to be German puppets. They were referred to as Germano-Bolsheviks. Count Mirbach, the German ambassador, was described by the US ambassador as, quote, the real dictator of Russia, end quote. It was taken as a fact by these people that the Bolsheviks were supposedly funded by German intelligence, that the Red Guards were led and trained by German officers. The Allied leaders seriously imagined that from the prisoner of war camps of Russia, these starving, squalid, remote places, that from these camps would be recruited a new German army, millions strong, armed and equipped from the Allies' own bloated supply depots in Vladivostok and Murmansk. Here comes my customary apology for Slavic names that I may mispronounce. Sorry in advance. Anti-Semitic conspiracy theories were expounded by, among many others, Winston Churchill, to whom the Reds were, quote, a strange band of Jewish adventurers, end quote, and the London Times, to whom they were, quote, adventurers of German Jewish blood in German pay, end quote. Western journalists knew so little about the Bolsheviks that they confused them, perhaps through a clumsy translation, with a different group called the SR Maximalists. The Bolsheviks were an open mass party which rejected terrorism, which had hundreds of thousands of members. The Maximalists were a conspiratorial terrorist outfit with a membership of maybe 1,000. But even without the translation problems, many in the Allied camp probably would not have known the difference. They behaved exactly as if a couple of hundred Bohemian bomb throwers had stumbled into power by accident. In fairness, some were in hindsight more sensible. The English Tory Arthur Balfour reasoned that hostility to the Soviets would push them into the arms of the Germans. On the other hand, a pragmatic accommodation with the Soviets might deny the Germans resources and the opportunity to redeploy their armies to the west. But the likes of Balfour were up against others whose grasp on reality was less firm. Western diplomacy, in short, boycotted Moscow and only communicated with it through intermediaries. Journalists who were actually in Russia in the first half of 1918 tried to convey the reality. Louise Bryant from the US bore witness to a revolution that was remarkable for its clemency and tolerance, that had mass support, and that had already made dramatic improvements to the lives of workers, women, and peasants, as recorded in her book, 6 Red Months in Revolutionary Russia. On Stockholm, on her way out of Russia in early summer, she met, quote, a correspondent from one of our biggest press agencies, end quote, who immediately described the Bolsheviks as scum. Now I'm quoting from Bryant's book, I felt myself forced to ask one more question. If you had to choose between the Bolsheviki and the Germans, which would you prefer? Without hesitating, he replied, the Germans. Have you ever been in Russia? No. That was two questions, Louise, but I'll allow it. Why were they so hostile? We can dismiss any notion that Allied hostility was based on a prophetic fear of Stalinist totalitarianism. On the contrary, they denounced anarchy, chaos, adventurism, etc. The picture of Bolshevism in their heads was quite the opposite of the totalitarian caricature. The real reasons they were hostile were as follows. 1. Because the Bolsheviks had pulled Russia out of the war. This became especially urgent from spring 1918 as German forces made a devastating offensive in the west and Turkey seized Baku in the south. 2. Because the revolution had renounced Russia's debts to the Allied countries and had nationalized foreign-owned industries. 3. Not least, because the Bolsheviks had made a socialist revolution, which might inspire the workers to take power in other parts of the world, thus threatening the powers that be in the Allied countries. From the very start, the Allied powers supported the White Guards in the incipient civil war. On December 2, 1917, the British cabinet voted to give money to the counter-revolutionary armies of Alexeyev and Kaledin. On December 23rd, Britain and France did a carve-up of their respective spheres of influence in Russia. Britain's sphere corresponded suspiciously close to British money invested in the oil of the Caucasus. Meanwhile, France's sphere of influence corresponded suspiciously to French money invested in Ukrainian coal and iron.
Why? Why have all these attempts been made to conquer Russia? Perhaps Russia itself can provide the answer. Here it is, 1/6 of the Earth's surface, reaching from east to west nearly halfway around the world, and southward from the North Pole to the borders of India. One country of 9 million square miles. That's our own country 3 times over, or all of North America and 1 million square miles to boot. The sun never sets on Russia. When it is dusk on its western borders facing Europe, it is already dawn on its eastern borders facing the Pacific. That's Russia, or to be correct, the Union of Soviet Socialist Republics. deep in its mountains lie thick, rich veins of gold and silver. There's coal, ton upon ton. And more important, there's also oil. 213 million barrels a year of it. Black gold flowing from the earth that contains 55% of the world's oil. What else? Iron? Russia has better than 10 billion tons. That can make a lot of steel before it's done. Yes, Russia is rich. Her farms cover millions upon millions of acres. The rich black earth that, besides giving forth oil and coal, will also grow everything from sunflowers to lotus.
Early on, the Soviets tried to come to an understanding with the Allies, and there were always voices in the Allied camp ready to come to an understanding with the Soviets. With the ever-present threat of the German military, even after the signing of the Brest-Litovsk Treaty, a pragmatic orientation to the Allies made sense. And this opens up a vista of what-ifs and alternate histories. For example, in relation to Murmansk in the north, a British battleship fired a salute to the Red Flag, and an Allied train went out on an expedition to the aid of Red Finns against White Finns. Some Bolsheviks opposed this cooperation on principle. But Lenin spoke for most when he said, the immortal words, quote, "We will accept guns and potatoes from the Anglo-French imperialist bandits," end quote. The Americans were reluctant to intervene at first. President Wilson believed his democratic peace plan, known as the 14 points, would be enough to encourage the Russians to rejoin the war. And I read that 30,000 copies of this peace plan were pasted up by American agents all over the walls of Petrograd. Early on, the Soviet regime planned to have a mass civilian militia instead of a standing army. It was in response to the threat of the German military, not in response to the White Guards at all, that the Soviet regime shelved this idea and began from February to build the Red Army. The Red Army's first battles at Pskov and Narva, commemorated annually in Russia and beyond even to the present day, were not against the Whites or the Allies, but against the German invasion of late February. Meanwhile, in Ukraine, the Red Army fought alongside an Allied force against the Germans. So the Reds and the Allies were fighting side by side. This Allied force was the Czechoslovak Legion. A Red commander paid tribute to the Czechs' fight against the German advance with the following glowing words, quote, "The revolutionary armies of South Russia," his words not mine, "will never forget the brotherly aid which was granted by the Czech Corps in the struggle of the toiling people against the hordes of base imperialism." So the Germans were the hordes of base imperialism. Germano-Bolsheviks, indeed. But the World War was the all-consuming priority. And that eventually trumped any basis for cooperation. Allied representatives promised aid, if only the Soviets would force their own people back into the trenches. They said, "We'll give you officers, we'll give you rifles, if you fight the Germans." But the Soviets would not force their own people at gunpoint back into the trenches, and Allied attitudes hardened. Russia, meanwhile, was crawling with Allied military missions, officials, agents, officers, attachés, a legacy of the war. By May 1918, this apparatus was busy making links and distributing funds. AJP Taylor writes, quote, "They imagined that somewhere in Russia was to be found some group of people who wanted to continue the war," end quote. Here's the thing, the wealthy, many of the officers, and many of the professional classes did want to continue the war. They felt humiliated and threatened by the revolution. They believed that the fatherland and our civilization were about to perish. They still possessed enough wealth, connections, self-confidence, and skills to fight back. These people formed leagues, networks, councils. They linked up with foreign powers. Funds were transferred, plans laid, promises made. A feverish activity is carrying on this whole time, in other words. At this point, the intelligentsia were deeply conflicted about the revolution, symbolized in the split within the SRs. Looking at where the two sides stood in May 1918, it's difficult to imagine that they had ever been in one party. The left SRs held high positions in the Soviets, in the fledgling Red Army, and in the Cheka, while the right SRs were in various leagues and councils in the underground counter-revolution, shoulder to shoulder with Black Hundreds and Tsarist generals. In that milieu, they nursed their grudges over the Constituent Assembly and waited for a chance to strike back. Thus, the Allies saw the Soviets as an enemy and, crucially, possessed the assets on the ground to wage a struggle against them. Let's clear something up about the Allies' motivations here, because it's often said as if it's told as if they just kind of bumbled into intervention accidentally. The original purpose of intervention, it is true, was to rebuild a front against the Germans in Russia, either with the Reds or over their dead bodies. It's sometimes denied that the Allies wanted at this stage to overthrow the Reds. They did not admit to it. But this second aim of intervention, the overthrow of the Soviet regime, was neatly encapsulated in the first aim from the very beginning. How are you going to build up an army and set up a new front line in the east without overthrowing the government in Moscow? If the destruction of the Soviet power was only of secondary concern at this point, that's only because the Allies had such utter contempt for the Soviet regime. They believed, basically, that something akin to the tooting popular front had seized power by accident and it would be a temporary, hilarious episode. They believed the Soviet regime would collapse sooner or later, with or without their intervention. The first aim was foremost while the war continued. The second aim became obvious when intervention not only continued, but deepened after the war's end. But counter-revolution would not have assumed the explosive form it did without the Czech Legion. I've mentioned them once or twice. Any reasonable person listening to this is wondering, what the hell is a Czech army doing in the middle of Russia? So, the Czech Legion. And it's okay to call them Czech because 90% of them were Czech and not Slovakian. But anyway, on Russian soil in 1918, there were tens of thousands of Czech and Slovakian soldiers. Czechia and Slovakia were oppressed by the Austro-Hungarian Empire. A Czechoslovak Legion was initially recruited from among Czech immigrants in Russia, then from among prisoners of war. They were induced to fight with the promise of an independent state after the war. By 1917, the Czechs made up a whole corps, numbering 30,000 to 70,000, and fighting on the Eastern Front against the Germans and Austrians. The Czechs did not join the Russian Revolution. While the Russian military disintegrated, the Czechoslovak Legion remained cohesive. The Russian soldier deserted and went home to his land. The Czech had no home. He was fighting against Germany and Austria to secure one, and he was determined to carry on that fight. It also looked like the Allied powers would be able to grant them that wish. Virtually all other military forces, but white and red, were either in the final stages of collapse or just coming into being at this point. So this is this weird interregnum or transitionary moment where there's pretty much no other army in Russia. So in the Legion, the Allies possessed a unique asset that could really test the strength of Soviet power, a military force that was large, cohesive, and, crucially, present with boots on the ground where it mattered. Together you can see the outlines of what the Allied plans were. A revolt of the Czech Legion against Soviet power, possibly linking up with the white warlord Semyonov, who was raiding across the border from China. Secondly, several central Russian towns would be seized by the underground networks of officers, Black Hundreds, Right SRs, etc., designed to kind of encircle Moscow. Third, the Czechs and the White Guards would link up with the British, the French, and the US forces at Arkhangelsk in the far north of Russia. Fourth, another element of the plan was outlined by Balfour, previously a critic of intervention. The Czechs could be used to trigger a conflict, drawing in Japan and the US, who had been reluctant up to that point. Quote, if we act, Japanese will. If the Japanese do, the United States will. End quote. General Laverne of the French mission, after explaining this plan to a colleague, added, but I shall feel guilty because if our plan succeeds, the famine in Russia will be terrible. The plan did not succeed entirely, but as we will see, the resulting famine was indeed terrible, probably beyond Laverne's ability to comprehend. The French had a second misgiving about the plan. They'd rather have the Czechs on the Western Front. But these were misgivings, reservations, not opposition. Simply put, Allied agents had been plotting for a Czechoslovak revolt since late 1917. The Czechs themselves, for the most part, just wanted to get the hell out of Russia and to fight on the Western Front. Both the Tsar and, to a lesser extent, Kerensky had refused to let them go. The Reds, however, made a sincere effort to grant their wish to get them out of Russia. At first, there was no ill feeling between the Reds and the Czechs. As we've seen, they fought side by side. The Czech rank and file were mostly Republican or Social Democratic in their sympathies. The Czech leader, Masaryk, had ignored appeals from Alexeyev to join the White Guards. The Reds allowed them to travel with 168 rifles and one machine gun per carriage. This shows trust, not draconian suspicion. And on top of this, the Czechs had concealed weapons. But the Soviets were bedeviled by the challenges of transporting tens of thousands of soldiers out of this vast Hungary war-torn territory. First, it was decided by the Reds and the Allies that the Czechs were to circumnavigate the globe via North America to get from the Eastern Front to the Western Front. So the Soviets began to move the Czechs from European Russia to the Pacific Ocean. But on April the 4th, Japan, a member of the Allies, made a landing at Vladivostok in the Far East, which was the Czechs' destination. Naturally, with Japanese soldiers in occupation of the city, they weren't going to send the Czechs there. This turned out to be just like a tentative landing. They cleared out again after a few weeks. But later that year, the Japanese would occupy all of eastern Siberia with an army of tens of thousands. So Moscow believed that the landing was part of a full-scale invasion, and this was an entirely reasonable belief. This fear meant that the Czechs were left stranded for a week, strung out in detachments all along the Trans-Siberian Railway from the Volga to Vladivostok. Tension was rising. On April 14th, a Czech Congress demanded more weapons plus control over their locomotives. It was far from pleasant for the Czechs to be high and dry at railway stations spread out across the whole breadth of revolutionary Russia. Raids by white warlords caused further delays, and these delays bred distrust. Local Soviets were sometimes uncooperative, even hostile. The Czechs, egged on by SRs and Allied agents, suspected that the Soviets were working hand in hand with the Germans and were somehow plotting to hand them over, where they'd be all locked up or shot. The Soviets, on their side, suspected that the Czechs might join the white Allied cause. Czech fears were delusional, in that there were no German soldiers within thousands of kilometres of even the westernmost of the Czech detachments. But there was a basis for this fear, in that millions of people were moving across Russia at that moment in the opposite direction to the Czechs. These were liberated prisoners of war from the German, Austro-Hungarian and Turkish empires, released and being borne home. Among them, by the way, was Josip Broz, who would later be known as Tito, Bela Kun, who would lead the Hungarian Soviet Republic, and the writer Jaroslav Hasek. Some of these former POWs were recruited into the Red Army. The British regarded them wrongly as mercenaries or as wretched conscripts. The Czechs identified them as proxy Germans, as a threat. And even if they weren't a threat, they were still a nuisance to the Czechs, burdening the railway system and causing further delays. The tragedy is that these people should have all been on the same side. Czechs, Hungarians, Yugoslavs, all subject peoples of Austria. And like the Czechs, all they wanted to do was go home. And no doubt, like the Czechs, they were frustrated with the state of the railways and the often squalid and chaotic conditions in Russia, and suddenly having to wait for a week in a station because the whole railway system was overburdened by tens of thousands of Czech dudes with rifles moving east. In short, there was a massive armed-to-the-teeth traffic jam on the railways. Every railway station and siding was a microcosm of Central Europe, and there was no solution in sight. An alternative plan to move half of the Czechs up north and ship them out of Arkhangelsk was agreed by the Allies and the Soviets, but the Czechs were angry and suspicious when they were told this plan, and they were further frustrated by another week-long delay caused by attacks by the Whites. On May 14th, Czechs going east and Hungarians going west met at a railway station in the Ural Mountains town of Chelyabinsk. In that same town at that moment, a Czech Congress was taking place discussing how best to get out of Russia. At first, the Czechs and Hungarians were friendly enough. The Czechs shared their rations with the Hungarians. Then an argument broke out, I don't know what over, and a Hungarian threw a scrap of iron taken from a pot or a stove at a group of Czechs. Someone fell. My sources are not sure if it was a fatality or an injury. If it was a fatality, you can make a case that it was the first fatality of the Russian Civil War proper. The Czechs lynched the Hungarian who threw the piece of iron. The Chelyabinsk town Soviet investigated the murder and arrested several Czechs for questioning. The Czechs locally were furious. They sent two battalions into town, disarmed the Red Guards, seized the arsenal, and freed their comrades. The situation in Chelyabinsk, crazy and all as it was actually settled by negotiations. But by the time it was settled, word of it had gone around the world twice, and there was no going back. Quote, to the Bolsheviks, the Chelyabinsk incident must have looked like unprovoked aggression. Trotsky, the commissar for war, ordered the arrest and disarming of the entire Czechoslovak corps. I've mentioned that there was a conference going on in Chelyabinsk during all this drama. Allied agents met with the leaders of the Czech Legion at this conference, and on May 23rd, the Czechs made a fateful decision. They agreed to join an all-out armed struggle against the Soviets, led by the Allies. 2 days later, on May 25th, Trotsky ordered that the Czechs not just be disarmed, but that any armed Czechs be shot on the spot. Violence was flaring up in half a dozen places along the Trans-Siberian Railway. In town after town, the Czechs drove out the Soviet power. The Czech Revolt presented an opportunity for all the organizations of counter-revolutionaries and many of the Cossack hosts to rise up. Quote, revolt flared along the powder trail at a Czech Legion scattered elements, stretching over 4,900 miles of the Trans-Siberian Railway.
A spokesman said, this is the one thing we didn't want to happen.
There were 15,000 Czechs in Vladivostok who were still there because the Allies had, through negligence or design, failed to provide ships to get them out. On June 25th, these Czechs seized the town and linked up with the Allied naval forces, which had been gradually massing in the harbour all year. By this stage, they were fully committed to all-out war. It's a common trope that all this was just a string of misunderstandings. I have a less charitable interpretation. It seems clear to me, beneath the usual plausible deniability that you always get in stuff like this, the British and French governments each played a role in using the Czechs to trigger a war. The French policy was more reluctant, but they were also more active in funding Russian counter-revolutionary groups. All in all, I'm not going to get into like smoking guns or whatever, but I'll focus on the broad context. It's difficult to see how things have gone down the way they did without the crucial context of the Allies and their utterly deluded project of rebuilding a fighting front in the East against Germany. Meanwhile, the Czechs' perspective seems to have been that the Bolshevik adventure would collapse and a new Eastern Front for World War I would take shape in Russia. It was similar to the Allied point of view. What they ended up doing was setting up a new Eastern Front within the Russian Civil War. Their tragedy is that all they wanted to do was get the hell out. But in their impatience, they triggered a war from which they would struggle to extricate themselves for two more years.
A spokesman said, this is the one thing we didn't want to happen.
The plans of Britain and France did not come to full fruition. Their forces in the Arctic would have been too little too late to help the Czechs or the Whites. That would be if the Czechs had consented to march north, which they did not. The plan for White Guard risings fell short by a long way, as we'll see in the next post. In short, the British and French conspiracy came off about as well as any plan of such ambition and scale could be expected to, in the confusion and vast distances of revolutionary Russia. It has to be said that they spectacularly underestimated the stability and social base of the Soviet regime as well. But that last point was not at all obvious in the spring and summer of 1918. The result of all these plans was an earthquake under the feet of Soviet power.
At the request of the Allies, 42,000 Czechoslovak war prisoners seized the Trans-Siberian Railroad and held it against the Soviets. In the south, General Denikin was organizing a volunteer army against the Soviets. On the Volga, Chernov and Avksentiev were raising a people's army against the Soviets. In Kuban, General Borgayevsky was marshaling the Cossacks against the Soviets. A year after the revolution, the Soviet government was surrounded by 14 hostile armies operating on a front 7,000 miles long. They moved their government from Petrograd to Moscow and within the walls of the Kremlin. They shot the Tsar and all his family in the house in Yekaterinburg where they had been imprisoned. The death chamber.
Here we get into really interesting questions on historical causation. As I've remarked in another post, like, in history you can have sparks that ignite conflicts, you know, but what really makes the conflict is not the spark, it's the fuel that's been piled up. The thing is, you can have fuel piling up and then never have a spark, you know. In this case, you had the underground right-wing officers' leagues and whatnot, and Cossack hosts and disgruntled SRs and Mensheviks who were willing to start an uprising against the Soviet power. But without the opportunity provided by the Czech Legion, that fuel might never have been lit. Or it mightn't have been lit in such a spectacular way. It might have fizzled itself out over time. So what we're really witnessing here is not just a tragedy for the Czechs and not just an episodic revolt, but really the event that sparks the Russian Civil War proper. And now we're going to get into the details of that, of how the Czech Revolt provided an opportunity for all these white governments. So we're going to focus on a government called Komuch. Under the wing of the Czechs, new white governments sprouted like mushrooms after rain. They expanded, shrank, absorbed one another peacefully or at gunpoint. The most interesting of these new governments was led by the right SRs. In early June, the Czechs were passing through the town of Samara on the Volga on their way east. Local right SR party members made contact with the Czechs, convinced them to stay and help them seize power. And the Czechs agreed. On June 9th at dawn, they overthrew Soviet power in Samara. That evening, a body was set up called the Committee of Members of the Constituent Assembly. This name is abbreviated in Russian as Komuch. And it claimed the dubious electoral mandate, which we looked at in part 3. Komuch was later referred to by Soviet historians as part of the democratic counter-revolution. It was not formally democratic in the sense of democratic freedoms and the rule of law and being elected and whatnot. No government was in Russia in 1918. The Constituent Assembly was in its name, but it never got a quorum of deputies together in one place. According to a report from the Komuch organ, quote, at Simbirsk, most of the Red Army soldiers captured in the town were shot. There was a real epidemic of lynchings, end quote. In August, Komuch set up its own repressive police organ, like Moscow's Cheka. But the term democratic counter-revolution does not refer to these forms. It refers to property. Komuch was bourgeois democratic in the classical sense. It was anti-landlord, but pro-capitalist. It did not attempt to give the landlords back their land, unlike virtually all other white governments. But it ended workers' power in the factories and it brought back the private owners. So that's Komuch, we'll be coming back to them in a few minutes. Let's just take a look at the Red Army and the Red Guards and ask the question, how were they coping with this revolt? When the Czechoslovak Legion revolted in the east, the Red Army was 1,000+ miles away and facing in the other direction. As Mosley says, quote, the new army was pointed backwards. Along with the simultaneous Cossack revolt in the south, which I looked at in the last episode, the Czech revolt marks the real start of the Civil War, and it should be obvious how little the Red Side expected or prepared for, much less planned or wanted that war. The Red Army had designated the Volga and the Urals as internal and not border regions, so little did the Soviet government anticipate civil war in the east, that their contingency plan in the event of a German invasion, as we've mentioned, was to retreat east and to form a republic in the Ural Mountains and Kuznets Basin. That was obviously off the agenda now. Meanwhile, in the Urals and along the middle third of the Great Arc of the Volga, local Soviets surrendered or fled without a fight. You had Red Guards rather than regular Red Army units. They tried to fight back, but they suffered humiliating defeats. Trotsky wanted to split the Czechs along class lines, and he would alternate dire threats and magnanimous appeals right up until November. but it was not to be. The Red Guards consisted of irregular detachments of workers, thrown together from whatever volunteers presented themselves. This had been enough, as we saw in the first two episodes, in the early, very early incipient phase of the Civil War, but now full-scale Civil War had broken out, and to win the Reds needed a real army. This was something that they did not have. Facing the Czechs near Chelyabinsk, for example, was a force of 1,000 armed Red Guards, made up of 13 local detachments, numbering from 9 members to 570, each with its own commander, each pretending it was autonomous, each giving the others headaches. Meanwhile, by the river Kishtima, Red Guards heard a rumour that the enemy were approaching their home villages, whole units deserted from the front line to go and defend their own homes. Nearby, the 7th Ural Regiment was just found to be absent from its positions one day. The commander reported, quote, "The men wanted to get themselves dry and have a sleep. They decided to go off for only half an hour, but they're still sleeping. I can't do any more." End quote. "Sorry, the front line isn't manned. The guys went off to have a nap and haven't come back," basically. Faced with this kind of feeble resistance, it's no surprise that the Czechs took over the Middle Volga region. Komuch would set up shop in each locality before the dust had settled. French officers would start to appear in great numbers. Students and Russian officers would go on a reign of terror against local workers. And Komuch would make half-hearted and impotent appeals for the killing to stop. According to the Czech nationalist leader, Beneš, the Czechoslovak army, on principle, shoot every Czech found fighting with the Red Guards and captured by them, for instance at Penza, Samara, Omsk, etc. In brackets, 200 at Samara, end quote. Komuch would restore the bosses to their factories, would end fixed grain prices, so it made big changes. On the other hand, it would confirm the peasants in their ownership of the former land of the nobles. It flew red flags over public buildings, and it held peasants' conferences. It formed a military force which it called the People's Army. It even attempted to set up a Soviet, which was hastily disbanded after it passed a Bolshevik resolution. At its height, this state had 12 million people in its territory. It held rich land, key transport links, and important cities such as the capital Samara. It included at its furthest reaches the factory town of Izhevsk, where the munitions workers, loyal to the right SRs, rose on their own initiative to join Komuch in a workers' army, a unique episode of an armed workers' revolt against, rather than for, the Soviets. On the other end of the social scale, the wealthy classes owed a lot to Komuch, but they did not repay it with loyalty. The well-off citizens were happy to carry out terror in the rear, wearing white armbands, going door-to-door, lynching suspected Bolsheviks, but in general, they did not deign to go anywhere near the front line. One business owner summed up the attitude of the wealthy to the struggle between Komuch and the Reds. Quote, "When two dogs are fighting, a third shouldn't join in." In the eyes of the bourgeoisie, the right SRs were on the same canine level as the Bolsheviks. We can safely assume that the wealthier peasants on the Middle Volga were happy to be out of the grip of Soviet power. Now they could sell their grain at whatever price they liked, or indeed not sell it at all. But the poor and middle peasants, who were more numerous, showed no enthusiasm for the new regime. The right SRs had received a very impressive vote in this region in the constituent assembly elections, but in the end, that didn't translate to very much in concrete and active terms. For example, there was the army. Komuch attempted to recruit 50,000 soldiers from the rural population. It only managed to recruit 10,000-15,000, and after this failure, they had to conscript 30,000 more people. There was no time to train them up, and arms were in short supply, so a large part of the people's army was shut up in barracks for most of their existence. There were small, capable detachments under a talented and popular commander, a Russian officer of the Czech Legion named V.O. Kapel. With considerable Czech assistance, these small, skilled detachments took town after town. But they were always being shuttled up and down the Volga, fighting the Reds in one place after another, and they were soon exhausted. In general, as we have seen, workers were hostile to Komuch. For every Izhevsk, there were several stories of heroism on the part of Red-aligned workers. For example, the people of Yekaterinburg, Verkhneuralsk, and Troitsk, miners and factory workers, formed a partisan army to oppose the Czech revolt. This army consisted of 10,000 fighters, followed by civilians in carts with all their samovars and their household linen. Surrounded, They had to fight their way over mountain ridges and across rivers, covering 1,000 miles in 50 days. Arms were scarce. Many fought with pikes and clubs and even old weapons from museums. They manufactured their own bullets whenever they could find equipment. The remarkable thing is, at around the same time, a similar Anabasis-like story was taking place in the south, where the Taman Red Army escaped from the Kuban Cossacks, as recorded and immortalized in the great novel by Alexander Serafimovich, The Iron Flood. But heroism by itself was not sufficient to win the war. It mattered, however. So Robert Service, the historian, writes that the October Revolution was basically a matter of Trotsky riling up a bunch of disgruntled soldiers. Another historian, Adam Ullum, claims that the Bolsheviks deliberately fomented chaos in order to step into a power vacuum. There's a documentary you'll find on Netflix on the Russian Revolution, which actually gives no reason for the success of the Bolsheviks except, quote, the skillful use of black propaganda. But the revolution was not some trick played behind the backs of the people. It would not have survived without the sincere enthusiasm of millions of people. The heroic marches in the Urals and with the Taman Red Army in the Kuban were of secondary military significance in themselves, but they were evidence of that enthusiasm and spirit of self-sacrifice, which proved decisive at this moment and would prove decisive again and again over the next few years. And you'll see that as the series goes on.
An old social revolutionary Tchaikovsky forming an anti-Bolshevik government at Archangel invited Great Britain to help him. Great Britain accepted. Tchaikovsky also, through our ambassador, Francis, invited the Americans. And they accepted. The Japanese invaded Siberia with an army of 70,000 men. The Japanese battleship Hizan in the harbor of Vladivostok. Japan invited President Wilson to join her, and Wilson agreed to send a few thousand troops. The American battleship, South Dakota, in the harbor of Vladivostok. France, Italy, and England also sent a few thousand troops, and Vladivostok became an international war camp. So great was the variety of uniforms, flags, decorations, and complexions that it seemed, but for the bloodshed, almost like a comic opera.
Next, we're going to look at the rival to Komuch, another white government of a very different character. While Komuch fought with the Reds to the west, it was waging a peaceful but bitter struggle with a rival white government that had sprung up to its east, the Provisional Siberian Government. The vast expanse of Siberia was populated by Russian settlers and a wide range of indigenous peoples. Class distinctions were not so sharp here as elsewhere, and the Communist Party had received only 10% of constituent assembly votes, as against 25% nationally. Three quarters of Siberian votes had gone to the SRs. Since then, ham-fisted attacks on the farmers' cooperatives, apparently, had damaged the popularity of the Soviets. There were solid Red Guard units in Siberia, but they were away beyond Lake Baikal, far to the east, battling the warlords Semyonov and Ungern. Meanwhile, there were several Cossack hosts in Siberia ready to kick off rebellion at any moment. The Siberian host alone numbered 170,000, and an underground white network of 8,000 officers. One-third of them were concentrated in the city of Omsk. They were also ready to kick off at any moment. Obviously, when the Czech Revolt took place, all this dry kindling went up in flames. The Cossacks and the officers rose up. Here, as on the Volga, Czech assistance was key. There was only one city, Tomsk, which the Siberian whites captured without Czech assistance. But Soviet power was wiped off the map of Siberia. The workers took to the forests and formed the nuclei that would later become Red Partisan Armies. From the chaos, emerged a new power centered on the city of Omsk, which we've mentioned, the Provisional Siberian Government founded at the end of May. This government flew a green and white Siberian flag, white for snow and green for the coniferous trees of the taiga. This was a nod to the tradition of Siberian regionalism, which the Omsk government managed to bring on board, albeit in a way that was only skin deep. In reality, it was not a popular regionalist type government. It was a stern, conservative regime which represented the rifles and sabers of Tsarist military remnants, not any popular mandate, even a contrived one. Here's the funny thing. In Siberia, the SRs were even more popular than they were on the Volga. But in Siberia, even more so than on the Volga, this support base punched below its weight. This proves how passive and confused that Constituent Assembly vote was, how questionably relevant it was in a situation where the conflict had gone as sharp as the point of civil war. There was an elected Siberian regional Duma, which Komuch and the SRs attempted to convene, but the Omsk government shut it down. This was one of many significant clashes between Komuch and Omsk. Komuch was not the only example of the democratic counter-revolution. In order to give a kind of a preview of what was going to happen between Komuch and Omsk, let's get ahead of ourselves chronologically to look at the trajectory of some of the other governments in a similar mold to Komuch. Basically, all over Russia at this point, new governments are being set up. Counter-revolutionary governments, British officers, French officers all over the place, Cossacks all over the place, in every example. Let's look at the British coming over the mountains from Persia, linked up with an uprising in the Trans-Caspian region, modern-day Turkmenistan, on 11th to 12th of July of 1918. The Reds were chased out, and a Trans-Caspian provisional government, led by SRs and Mensheviks, ruled there until January, when it was replaced by the far more conservative Committee of Social Salvation. In July 1919, in turn, this government merged with the White regime of General Denikin in the south of Russia. So what's the trajectory here? In short, this Central Asian equivalent of Komuch began with some Menshevik railway workers, and it ended up being cannibalized by reactionary generals. The snows of Arctic Russia saw the same political developments, basically, as the sands of Central Asia, only at an even faster pace. On August the 2nd, British forces landed at Arkhangelsk. On the same day, the Arkhangelsk Soviet was overthrown in a military coup, and the Supreme Administration of North Russia came to power. This government was staffed by right SRs and led by a guy called Tchaikovsky of the Popular Socialist Party, which was actually not all that popular. It didn't even register in the Constituent Assembly election results. On September 6th, the local military forces, supported by the Allies, overthrew this moderate socialist government. Tchaikovsky was first deposed, then brought back into the fold tentatively, and then exiled. The historian Jonathan Smeal writes, quote, "On the day of Tchaikovsky's departure, the 1st of January 1919, there duly arrived at Arkhangelsk General E.K. Miller, who was to become military governor of the region for the remainder of the civil war in the north. They must have passed each other in the harbour. Socialist democracy was leaving Russia as white militarism disembarked." End quote. The democratic counter-revolution had suffered the same fate in Central Asia and in the Arctic Circle. A government of moderate socialists had come to power with the help of right-wing authoritarian officers and allied interventionists, only to realise sooner or later that it existed on their sufferance, that it had no social base of its own, that in the polarised conditions of civil war, the fate of moderates could not be a happy one. And in the next number of episodes, you're going to see the answer to the question, would things turn out the same way for Komuch? Who would win in the struggle between Komuch and Omsk? But at the height of the revolt in Siberia, in July 1918, seismic events occurred behind red lines, and these will be the focus of the next post. I go to bed feeling the same way. I ain't nothing but tired. Man, I'm just tired and bored with myself. Hey, baby, I could use